basically, I have been in constant motion pretty much a whole part of my life because my father was in the government service and we used to move from city to city. So I think the only constant for me was books because I had to keep making friends over and over again. So whether I was changing schools or careers, basically I have been a journalist and I have been in advertising after my MBA for about say 12 odd years. And through all of that, reading was a constant. Of course, when there are other interesting things. Hello?
Yes.
Yeah, audible?
Yes, currently, yes.
Yeah, so there was, teenage hormones take over the reading. So for a long time, I wasn't reading, and there were other interesting things to do, and being out with friends and partying and this, that, and the other. But I always used to write poetry, more than writing novels or anything. I used to write a lot of poetry, very unfortunate sounding poetry, might I add, because my father used to travel a lot. So I used to write these four, rhyming lines every single time he was out. And I used to continue writing in my journal, but the novel came about actually much later on my maternity break, which is when you must have heard a lot of women take to writing. So that's when I started as well. And honestly speaking, Ronak, at that point in time, I didn't, people think I make this up whenever I'm doing these interviews, but the point is, I honestly had no intention, nor did I even plan that I would ever have a book out. It was something that I wanted to just get out because there was so much happening around me. I was in my maternity break and there was a very, like a virtual circus happening around me with, advice and bawling babies and this, that, and the other. And I've always had a sense of humor in the way I look at things to make it more palatable. When you're in a situation, you just look at things a little differently. So that's what I did as well. And whatever was happening around me, I channelized onto paper. And it sounds like I planned it out, but in about 8 or 9 months, the same time it took for me to produce my actual baby, I was done with the book and it was just done and dusted. That's why that's, and it actually sat and languished there for a long time till I met Ravinder Singh and happened to. So I wrote for TOI India, Times of India, the writing platform. So
Okay.
I sent in a story there and I was in the top 10 and I just happened to, this is what they say that whenever, destiny needs to find you where you're supposed to be and things are meant to happen, they do. Because just on a lark, I remember I was traveling that day and I had to push myself to go for that ceremony and I just went. I happened to meet him and I said, look, I know it must be terrible. That's what all writers tell themselves that, but do you want to take a look at it? And he looked at it and then HarperCollins came on board and that's how my first book happened. So it was called I Didn't Expect to Be Expecting. And it was a humorous take on pregnancy. So that's what the book was about. So that essentially in a nutshell is how the first book came around.
Okay, like the way you speak and the way you wrote, I can imagine both are like almost 100% similar.
Yeah, exactly. So unfortunately, what happens is first books are always autobiographical in nature, but I never accept this in interviews because I know once I went for this radio interview and the RJ asked me that she was like, so who are these characters and this mother-in-law and this, that, and the other. Like a fool, I went around and I was like, I was very inspired by my own mother-in-law, but this, that, and the other. And I did this whole confession, not realizing that my mother-in-law would eventually hear it. So I heard a massive earful at the end of it. So yes, I mean, it draws from real life for sure. But yeah, then you mix it around. So first few books tend to be like that. My second book, Kanpur Khufiya Private Limited, which you've read, clearly is not based on anybody in my life. But yes, it draws from the fact that I'm from Kanpur. And I haven't been back since I was a child. And but there's a lot of memories from there. And the way what I've absorbed growing up, as part of what's happening in the house, the culture. So all of that kind of trickled down into the characters and how they behave, on a daily basis. So those nuances came around, from my experiences as a child.
Yes, that's true. But like, obviously, we'll come to the latest book. But my question is,
Sure.
from writing the last book, like I'm expected to be, and the completely transferring to the another genre, like how do you feel? How do you write to about to think like completely to genre?
So, Ronak, that's the whole thing, So, when you start writing, so it's very, I don't know whether it's fortunate or unfortunate, but I've got, I am not a Gemini, I'm a Sagittarius, but I feel like there's these two people inside me. So half of me writes very serious poetry, you know, that dil tootne wali, you know, main aur meri tanhai kind of poetry, which, you know, sab dard nikal diya, that kind of poetry. And the other half of me always, yes, yeah, seriously, utna achha nahi, but, you know, I write a lot of, you know, really sad, you know, sad poetry and cathartic, you know, poetry. And the other half of me always, always looks at things in a humorous way, you know. So there's always a tussle. But what comes naturally to me in a long format has always been humor, right? So when I started writing, I didn't expect to be expecting happen. But if you see the commonality between this, the first book, which is also contemporary fiction, and the second one, which is a thriller, is that humor is a constant. So what the second book helped me do was that while it was still humor, it also helped me put a foot in another category, another genre, which is obviously thrillers and mystery. You know, there was a big tussle when we were deciding the positioning of the second book, because they said that it's a thriller. And I said, I told HarperCollins, I was like, no, it is not a thriller. It is a humorous thriller. You know, because the slotting that mentally people do, you know, when you talk about another genre altogether is, you know, they start thinking of similar books in that genre. And this somehow, you know, I felt that it was always somewhere in the middle. So while some people have told me, I didn't want to mislead people. So this is in a sense somewhere in between humor and fiction. So the commonality to your previous question, how is it that it's too, what, you know, what was the transition? It was very hard writing it, because I am a massive consumer of thrillers and detective series and crime, which is like a worldwide trend, right? I love watching it. But what I realized was reading it and watching it on Netflix is so different when you're trying to create a plot, right? So it was very hard. So I don't know, the story chose me. That's something that, you know, I keep feeling that from when I move from one book topic to the other, somehow these different kinds of stories, you know, reach out to me. And somehow or the other, because I gravitate towards humor, that seems to be a common thread. But the genres keep on changing. For example, the third book that I've finished the first draft, and you'll always hear this, that the first draft is the crappiest thing ever. So yes. I've just finished my third book, and that is a completely different. So everybody was like, oh, okay, now you'll start writing thrillers. I said, aisa kuch nahi hai. You know, sometimes you just never know what the next one is. So again, humor's a thread. And my third one is another contemporary fiction story between a mother and a daughter who don't get along, and they have to take some kind of trip together, and things happen there. You know, it's like a comedy of errors and this, that, and the other. So honestly speaking, I don't consciously choose it. While I know I'll have to write an installment, second installment, because I've created a franchise out of Kanpur Khufiya, the genres, I'll let them, you know, pick me. I think initially humor will be a constant, but the stories, I guess, will just keep picking me.
Okay, so Netflix binge watching is the root cause of your book.
Oh, it has to be, seriously. So I you know, I tend to, so my daughter, unfortunately, so I don't let her watch much. So I'm an absolute hypocrite, because we don't let her watch much of, you know, TV. And but she knows that at the end of the week, you know, there'll be 2-3 hours when mama and papa will disappear into the, you know, their room, and they'll pretend like they're not watching. But she knows that, you know, now she knows what Netflix is. At 5.5 years, she's like, mama, no more Netflix. So I was like, oh, crap. So, yeah. So, but you know what, Ronak? Consuming a lot of this stuff, it really helps. So every time I'm writing, I surround myself with that kind of content. And it really helps, because, you know, it gets you in that frame of mind. So it's not that it's mindless watching. So sometimes my viewing is dictated by what I'm writing. Because if you surround yourself with that kind of stimulus, you know, it helps. Yes. It always helps you charge your mind.
Yes, that's true. Like, completely true. But the obviously, I already read the book. But my question is whether you already plot, whether you already complete plot, or you go with the flow. Like, how you do it?
Okay. Basically, there's structured writers and there's intuitive writers. There, obviously, what I was saying was, it depends on the genre as well. So all your crime, thrillers, sci-fi, these kind of genres tend to require more structure. So there are people who have, you know, I visited their homes with some author friends, and their room looks like some green room, back end room of CSI Miami, you know, because there's these small, small chits, you know, every scene is plotted out, you know, there's not just a plot, there is a chapter wise breakdown and there's post-its and notes around each. So that kind of structure. And there are others who will just do a broad outline and, you know, follow that. So I honestly tend to think that I am somewhere in the middle. I started off without a structure and without creating an outline. But what I've realized with every book is that it's you know, it is like it's a spine. It's the spine of your story. If you do not know broadly where you're going, somewhere along the way, you know, your story is going to lose form, just like it's missing a spine. So broad outlines are very important. But what I do is, what works for me is a broad outline, and then I write within that. So a broad outline is very important for me. Like if for KKPL 2 and for KKPL, I know what I'll have for Kanpur Khufiya. It's more important for me to have the ending in place and then write backwards. That's also a method some people follow. But for example, this third book, which is a story about the mother and daughter, I let the end be dictated by after I finish the book. Because, you know, you can. When it's a story about just, you know, relationships and people and this, that and the other, it all depends on where you want the characters to go and what you want to say in the story. But because it was a thriller and this, that and the other, in thrillers, I had to change my way of approaching the structure. So yes, net-net, structure is very important. But how detailed the structure is and how detailed your plotting is depends on the genre.
Yeah, okay. So like adding to this answer, like what do you think, which is the one important thing about any book or about your book? Whether it's cover, whether it's plot, whether it's character?
I honestly think that...
So if you prioritize, then what will you put it in the top and put it in the bottom?
Okay, so I think I'd put the story right at the top, okay? Then I would honestly put the title. And this has come to me with the experience of that I've had over the last three books. And then I would put the cover. So basically, the title, I think, because there are especially contemporary fiction, you know, literary fiction ka, there's a different channel completely. It goes to festivals, you know, and then there are enough people who will write about it. And there's, it follows a different kind of promotion. And the book goes through, a different structure in terms of before getting to the reader, because it's written about widely. For contemporary fiction, your best chance at grabbing that attention is because it is the reality of the trade that contemporary fiction sells best online and at airport stores. And at the retail shelves where there are, you know, you are sitting and battling with 300 titles, your best bet is just grabbing attention with a title. So I think title plays a very, very key role. And your, you know, that blurb, the blurb and your back page blurb, which is a synopsis of the story, and the title is very, very important because it really grabs attention, especially in the contemporary fiction space. But of course, if the basic plot in the story itself is not grabbing attention, then it's going to fall flat on its face in the first five pages. And if somebody has bought your book and you've caught their attention and then you're disappointing them, then it's horrible, right? Because then they'll make sure they'll come on your page and write crap about, give you a bad review. So the story is very important. But yes, the title, which I'm currently really struggling with for my third book, is very, very important as well.
Okay. So like we are talking about the plot and writing. So like, what is the one hardest thing about writing?
There are many hard things, Ronak, honestly. But the hardest thing is that, you know, it is a very isolating process. So while there are days when I really, really enjoy it. There are days where you are your own judge, right? So when you are proposing and you are disposing at the same time, it becomes a massive tussle between your brain and your heart, because writers are indulgent, you know, you're writing and criticizing yourself at the same time. So it's almost like, you know, you're in some madhouse
Right.
Where you're creating characters out of the air, it's all fiction, and you're constantly trying to tell yourself that don't worry, whatever, you know, insanity you're writing, somebody out there is going to appreciate the story, and somebody is going to, you know, identify with what you're writing with, so just keep at it. And then the next minute, you know, you're just like, oh my God, this is terrible. So, you know, I think it comes very naturally to write, but at the same time criticize yourself so much, but you have to know where you need to draw the line and pull yourself back so it doesn't kill your motivation to, you know, complete your story. So I think that is the hardest part, that you know, initially it's easy also, because when you're writing your first draft, you know, don't have to sell it to anyone, you're not trying to think of the readers, you're trying to think of getting a story out. So that way it's good because there's lesser noise, but at the same time it's a double-edged sword, because you are, you know, sitting there writing, and you are constantly, you know, writers are self-flagellation experts. Matlab karo bhi, and you know, you criticize yourself all the time. So I think that is something constant, which is a battle that's always going on mentally. And yeah, I change my expressions according to what's happening in my face. So sometimes people think I'm mad, but yeah, so that's hard.
Okay. So, like, before we move ahead, I have one question about your life. What is the biggest ups and downs in your life?
As in any, are you saying in my writing life or in life in general?
Life in general.
Life in general. Well, I think I wouldn't call it a down, but I was on a massive high as far as, you know, my career was concerned. I've always been rather, I mean, at the expense of sounding you know, vain, I've always been good at what I've done, and I was doing very well in my career. And when my maternity break came along, at that point in time I was peaking at my career, and you know, for a while I thought that it was an absolute setback. So I do remember being in the doldrums, and I know lots of people will identify with this because I've spoken with lots of people, and I think there is a correlation why people start writing, you know, when they take that break, is because there's so much going on, and you have, you know, you're at the confluence of so many decisions, and everything changes after that, and it depends on how much support you have. So, and to cut it short, that was one part of my life which was very tumultuous, and I was just like, you know, where was my life going and where is it now? But having said that, if I hadn't taken that break, I mean, I continued working after that, but if I hadn't taken that break, I would have never started writing, and this book would have never happened. So it was, you know, it was, and it was a problem for me, yeah, but it became an opportunity. And obviously, ups and downs continue. I try to keep myself positive. But yes, as a writer, everything that happens affects you. So, I mean, I don't talk about this much, but obviously there was a bereavement in my family last year where I lost my mom. So for a long time I couldn't write, and then I honestly think that the last book, which has done so well, she wrote it for me. So that was a major juncture in my life which I still haven't recovered from, but I honestly dedicated my second book to her because I know that I didn't have it in me, and she completed it for me. So basically, ups and downs really affect what you do as a person, as a writer, everything. And because we tend to write about emotions and all of, you know, you're putting all of yourself onto paper, it tends to come out. So, yeah, I mean, I have the same ups and downs as any other normal person would, but I've tried to, you know, take them in my stride like anyone would as well.
Yes, definitely. Like, so let's get into the latest book. So what is your book about? Please tell the, like, new audience who haven't read it.
Okay, so promotion phase on ting. Whenever I'm talking about the book, no, so I mean, it's very close to my heart. Basically, it is the story of an intrepid, oily haired detective. As soon as, you know, you think of detectives and, you know, Perry Mason and these smart men walking around, you know, Sherlock Holmes, this, that and the other, you know, all these images come to my head. But this is this sweet, endearing little man from Kanpur, Gwaltoli, who has this one dream of becoming India's most, or, I mean, he doesn't dream that, but he just wants to be, you know, a very famous detective. Not, he doesn't want to be famous, he just wants to be a great detective who, you know, helps people as much as he can. And he's intelligent, he's sharp, but he's always had this one passion. Unfortunately, he doesn't have the support of his family, a typical family in UP who wants him to, I mean, father wants him to go to IIT, and, you know, mother's not happy with what he's doing either because she thinks that this makes him a laughing stock. But it's a story of this guy who follows his dream. And I think a lot of people have identified with that, is because at the core of it, we're all chasing something desperately. But half of us, you know, most of us lose steam along the way because it isn't easy to do. So he wants to become a detective. He, you know, does every, and the great part is his wife understands his ambition. So she, oddly, going against all, you know, expectations of what a wife should be doing, she's helping him run the agency. And, you know, life is chugging along. Business is not that great. People still laugh at what they do. But he keeps his faith. And one fine day, a case lands up, a simple seeming case, you know, a seemingly simple case lands up at their doorstep. And that is the beginning of this whole crazy roller coaster ride, because they get involved, unwittingly involved in a case, an abduction and a murder of an actress. An erstwhile actress, and then they get implicated in the crime, and how they exonerate themselves, and how he, staying true to himself, he solves the murder, and that's how he becomes famous and really actually realizes his dream through the, through Gwaltoli right up till Bombay. So that's where this entire story setting is. That is, in a nutshell, what the story is about. You know, sprinkled with the earthiness of a small town.
Yes. Oh, I already read the book, so I know every bit of it.
Exactly.
But I'm just waiting for the second part.
Oh, so that is already pucking in my head. So yeah, I've started kind of plotting that one out. So I hope it doesn't disappoint. Yeah.
So I guess the second book is like much more appreciated as compared to first. So like, how success feels to you after success, second book?
It feels great. See, just like you will never get the definition, exact definition of a bestseller from anyone, is the same way, it's the definition of success. I mean, I really don't know if I'm successful. All I do know is that the second book has been... is more in the limelight because it also got picked up for a screen adaptation, and that is a big honor for sure.
Yes, I know. I was going to ask you about it.
Yeah. So basically, I think from the numbers, and unfortunately, you'd love to think that you sit in one corner, write your book, go hide back in your corner and throw your book at your publisher and let them do the rest. But unfortunately, it's people like you who help. I mean, what Books Examiners and, the book reviewing community is doing is, helping the word get out there, because it is as much the responsibility of an author now to, drop their jholas and their shawls and get out there and push their book as much as possible. So, it's the necessity of the hour. So I've been doing that for both. But what has really helped the second one is somehow it's got... So the first one was about, in my head and from the numbers I heard, it did pretty decently. But the second one, suddenly, I think it caught the imagination of a lot of people that there's this small town guy. And somehow stories of small towns generally are doing well right now, right? It's... Everybody wants to know it just seems to be a trend. And then a detective coming out. So that's what the Endemol people said. So I recently met her, the lady who picked up the book at an event recently. And somebody was asking her that, why KKPL? What prompted you? So she said, this is something, this is the kind of content which is, which is from the heartland of India, but which can go international, because at the end of the day, people's motivations are the same. They might speak a different language and they might look a certain way, but it seems like that endearing quality about this character and the life he's got around him, and how simply he wants to just do what he wants to do, and he's not fazed by anything. So that kind of caught the imagination, and it being picked up by Endemol helped. But it's good. It feels great for it to be recognized and people talking about it. But I keep telling myself that that is just a bonus. What I need to do is keep my head down and churn at least 2-3 books out a year. Otherwise, I'll have my husband to face, because he's told me that he now wants me to become a book factory and just keep churning books out.
Yeah. So like, we are about to end this episode. Sure. But before we end, what's your motto in life?
Now there are 6, 7, 8 mottos flashing in front of my eyes, but honestly speaking, now you're making me choose, Ronak. Now I want to sound very profound and everything, but the one thing, you know, that comes to my mind, it might sound a little odd and negative and a little simplistic, but I keep thinking and telling myself, if at any point in life, that this too shall pass. Because whether you are, I know I don't want to sound philosophical, but what it means to me on two levels is, life is transient, you know, the good times will also pass, the bad times will also pass. So the best you can do is make merry, you know, when the times are great. And when times are not that great, just, you know, dig your head in the sand, let it pass, do your best, and then leave the rest up to God, because there's not much else you can do. Yeah, that was pretty philosophical, but I hope it helps.
Yeah, that's true. So I would like to end this conversation with one of the funny questions. Okay. As you are so humorous, so tell us something that nobody knows about you.
Oh my God, everybody will think I'm a freak. But okay, so I have a problem. I don't know if anybody's heard about this, but it's called misophonia.
Okay.
Misophonia. You've heard?
Yeah, I heard, but I don't know exactly.
Oh my God, it's terrible, Ronak. Basically, misophonia is this aversion. It's actually, so I had it for years. And only 2 years ago, I figured out it's a medical condition. So I'm officially kooky. So basically, it's a condition where if you hear, it's an aversion to extremely loud sounds. And especially chewing of food. So you can imagine, even my poor, nobody is spared, okay? Whether it's my in-laws, whether it's my father, whether it's my family, my poor 5-year-old daughter sitting and chewing in the table. If anybody is eating a papad, oh my God. I can shoot through the roof. Yeah. So it's a very, very odd problem to have. If somebody is, you know, if I'm working out in the gym and somebody just bangs the, you know, the gym weight down, that's it. I mean, the poor guy is going to be out of there in 5 minutes because I'm just going to scowl so hard. So now, you know, if I'm seen walking around the city scowling, it's not because I'm in a bad mood. It's because I've just heard a loud sound.
Now, seriously, I can't stop laughing.
No, seriously, it's a true condition. Just read it. And I have it.
Yeah. Okay. So everyone who is listening to this, I will put the link of the book in the description. Do check out. It's like one of the best book I came across on the thriller, mystery, humor, and so on. And obviously, the second part. The second part is coming soon, maybe 2020 or 21.
No, Ronak, I have to get it out faster. 2020.
Okay, so end of the 2020.
Yes.
So and this is going to be on the screen also. So before it goes on the screen, make sure you read it, you enjoy it, and I'm definitely going to enjoy it. So thank you so much for this awesome conversation.
Thank you, Ronak. And congratulations on reaching 10,000 on your Insta followers. Keep the good work going.
Thank you so much.